Welcome back, Brad here again. It is the 8th of March 2017. It is 3 days after completing my fitness competition, my first ever fitness competition where I came first in two separate divisions. I have two trophies, those two guys behind me, first place in two separate divisions. So I'm still on a high from that 3 days ago. But I thought I'd put this video together to share with the world 14 things that I learned in getting ready for my first ever fitness competition. This will be applicable for anybody watching this that's just wanting to lose weight, because you can take some of this stuff away and as tips and use it for your own weight loss journey, or anybody wanting to compete will get more value out of this video. So let's get straight into it. I'm going to break it down. I've got my notes here and I'll see you very shortly. Thank you so much for coming back. Let's get straight into it. Number one, you can win a competition with less than perfect conditions. So as you know, I won the competition in two separate divisions. Blows my mind even thinking that someone like me, an ordinary guy, I'm nobody special, can win a competition such as that with all the shit that went on in the last 3 months of my prep journey. If you haven't seen exactly what I went through the previous 3 months, go and check out, 40 plus videos of me going through night shift, working a corporate job, doing night shift, training while doing night shift, going overseas, being stuck in Thailand with the floods that, water up to my hips, up to my knees, going to the gym, training in Thailand with my runners on, going through water up to my knees to get to the gym to train, to keep going with my training progress. Not to mention injuring my back and a whole list of things, all this shit, Christmas and New Year celebrations and all these things that really throw people off any kind of weight loss program. I went through all of that, right? And I managed to push through all of that and got first place. In hell, that's crazy. It's just unbelievable. So the lesson learned there is that you can still win a competition even though you go through a whole lot of shit to get to the stage, that you can still succeed with less than perfect conditions. If you're watching this and you're only interested in weight loss, then just know that one cheat meal, going overseas, Christmas or New Year doesn't mean that it's the end of any kind of weight loss program that you choose to start. And there's no point waiting until you come back from overseas, that you wait until Christmas is finished, that you wait until January shows up before you start that New Year's resolution that 90% of people give up on by the 14th of January anyway. That all that's shit, and that the best time to start any kind of program, and I'm living proof of that, is right now in this moment. Now, I know this sounds a little bit airy-fairy, like rah-rah BS, but it's not, because this is the truth. Nobody can guarantee tomorrow. You just can't. Like, nobody can predict how your life will show up tomorrow. But right now, as you watch this video, as you sit on your couch or on the seat on your way to work and you're watching this in the train, on your mobile device or whatever, wherever you're streaming this video from, that right now is what's guaranteed. And that we know today is guaranteed, make the decision right now. That you got all this stuff coming up, weddings, birthdays, Christmas, New Year's, whatever the f*** it is, let's be brutally honest. Start that program right now. Right now. Because when I started my competition preparation journey, I started in November last year, in 2016. So that was one big thing I learned, and that's given me a lot of confidence that if I can smash through, win first place, with all that shit that I went through, that I can pretty much do anything, and so can you, because I'm nobody special, I'm just an ordinary guy. That I was committed to the program, and you have that capacity as well. If I can do it, you can do it too. The second thing is hiring a competition coach was the best investment. So I worked with a coach and Penny Lomax, and great lady. And so of course I did the work, but you know, it took the load off me by giving her the responsibility of structuring my meal plan, of structuring my training plan, of structuring my supplement plan. That, you know, leading up to the competition, she wanted to see photos of my physique to make sure that I was on track leading up to the stage. And so, sure, I could have done all of that myself, but there's so many moving pieces when it comes to a competition that it's a lot easier to get a coach. Now, if you're not looking at competing, you should get a coach if you can afford one. It's not necessary, but if it's within your means, you should consider getting a coach. You should. If you can't afford a coach, if it's not within your means, completely fine. Because if you know my journey, I got super lean on my own without any coaches or personal trainers and maintained that physique for a number of years before I started this competition journey very recently in the last 3 months or so. So if you can't afford a coach, that's fine. But just start doing your research, start learning, start planting the seed, start getting your mind around basic training principles, basic nutrition principles. There's nothing secret about getting lean. And if anyone tells you that you need to get lean, well, the only way to get lean is to take, you know, this secret ancient plant or pill or potion or some other shit, then you need to run and come and see me, because I'll tell you the truth and I'll tell you that losing weight, losing fat, building muscle is very straightforward, very straightforward. Just requires someone to tell you the truth, basically, about how it works. It's not as complicated as what most people make it out to believe. Whatever. And the next thing, posing fitness is underrated. Posing fitness is underrated. So, one of the hardest things that I went through during this competition preparation was learning the posing. It was really f***ing challenging because I'd never done it before. It was my first time learning the poses. I felt awkward. I felt it was sometimes embarrassing and it didn't feel right. And so because I'd been training for years and eating well, and you know, I was already quite lean, I already had a really good understanding of all of that, but I'd never posed in my life. I never had to. So learning the poses was challenging, and it's actually really hard to hold a position and flex your muscles for minutes at a time while 9 judges are looking at you and smiling and having that stage presence is a lot harder than what you think it is. And don't worry, I thought posing was really easy. Although you just get on the stage and you pose. No, there's like different ways of posing, and you know, by moving and shuffling your shoulders a certain way, you bring out certain types of muscles. And if your elbow gets pushed backwards, you close off your lat, and so the judges won't be able to see that lat, which means you get marked down and you lose points. So by simply shifting your elbow like this much, you bring out the lat on that side. The judges can see it, and it looks like you have a proportioned, well-balanced physique. It sounds crazy because it is. So learning how to position yourself so that when you do your transitions, so and smiling and breathing and you know flexing, it's really challenging. So if you're looking at competing, make sure you start posing practice as far ahead in advance as you can. I started about 6 weeks, 7, 8 weeks in advance. Like I started as much, even when I was traveling overseas through Thailand, I was posing. When I was, you know, at the Langham Hotel in the spa, I was posing. Here in my apartment, I was posing. In my bedroom in front of the mirror, I was posing. At 10, 11, 12 o'clock at night at the gym, I was posing. Wherever I had the opportunity, I posed. And I practiced for about 40 minutes to an hour every day, 4, 5, 6 days a week. I injured my back, if you remember that. I couldn't pose properly for about 2 weeks. I couldn't do the back pose. So there was the front pose, the side, and then the back. meant arching my lower back, and I couldn't do that. So I couldn't really pose properly for 2 weeks. So posing fitness is underrated. You need to practice your posing if you're looking at competing, and you need to practice far ahead in advance as possible. 30, 40, 50% of the marks are given to correct posing and transition on stage. And it's not just about having abs, it's not just about having a salesman smile, it's about how you present yourself on stage. The next one is, it's expensive. This has been an expensive exercise for me. I haven't sat down and added up all my receipts. There are a lot of receipts. I've kept most of my receipts from, you know, my coach, for example, $1,200 Australian, and then of course to enter the competition was $410. So two divisions plus photographs plus a video, you know, how you pay $45-$50 for videos on top of, you know, skydiving or hang gliding. Well, it's like an extra $50 for like the event photography and video. So whatever, $410 to register and everything. So plus all the supplements, which wasn't a great deal, but we're talking hundreds. And then of course, you know, the physio, because I remember I injured my back and I go see a physio. All these bits and pieces add up. We're probably talking about $3,000-$5,000, including food that I had to buy. If you factor in food, I would normally eat food anyway if I wasn't competing, but $2,000-$4,000. I'm gonna do a video and I'm gonna give you a breakdown of exactly how much. Right now I haven't added the receipts up. All I know is it's been an expensive exercise. Plus posing classes and one-on-one posing sessions with Vicky, $100 every session. Okay, next one. Intuitive eating works for comp prep until a certain point. Okay, so at the beginning of my comp prep journey, if you remember those videos at the early stages of this preparation, I was traveling through Thailand. I spent 2.5 weeks to 3 weeks in Thailand, and I was still training even though it was flooding and all that kind of stuff. Now, remember, I was already quite lean when I started my preparation journey. I was about 14% body fat when I first started. So I was able to be more flexible with what I ate when I was in Thailand. So that's why when I was in Thailand, I wasn't meal prepping. I was having green curries and I was sometimes skipping the rice. You know how if you've been to Thailand, you have your green curry and you have your rice on the side. Well, most times I'd push the rice aside, I'd give it to somebody else and I'd just have the green curry. I took my own protein with me, so I had a guaranteed protein source. Yada, yada, yada. I go into that in other videos. But the point was that I wasn't meal prepping, weighing, measuring my food because I wasn't staying in a place that had a kitchenette. However, I was training according to my program. So I took my training program with me and I took my protein with me. That was what I did to make sure that I kept making progress when I was in Thailand. And so intuitive eating just means that you eat when you're hungry and you stop eating when you're full. And it's a technique that is used to help somebody lose weight by using intuitive eating, provided that you're already familiar with how macronutrient breakdowns work, or IIFYM, or if it fits your macros. Don't worry, if you're watching this, you have no idea what I'm talking about, that's okay. But if you're watching this as somebody looking at competing, you have an understanding of those things I just mentioned. So if you're watching this and you're not concerned about competing, what I just said probably doesn't make any sense, and that's okay as well. The next point is, intuitive eating works for comp prep until a certain point. Okay, I'll elaborate on to a certain point. So because I was already quite lean, that meant that I was able to be intuitively eating my way through Thailand by being conscious of how many carbs I was eating and still make progress, and I did. I lost about 1/2 inch around my waist when I got back from 2.5 weeks, 3 weeks in Thailand. However, you need to meal prep and be quite strict the closer you get to competition. And so the 4 to 6 weeks leading up to the competition, I was meal prepping. I was weighing everything, I was measuring everything, I was tracking everything, because that's the only way to guarantee results, is to track your f***ing progress. I apologize for cursing, but this is brutally being honest. If you want to make progress on any kind of weight loss program, I don't care what anyone says, You must track your progress. You must. In vlog 01 or 03, the very beginning, I said I wanted to be 8% body fat. I was about 14% at the time. When I had my DEXA scan, I came in at 8.3%. Not bad, not bad at all. But that came about because I was able to track and monitor my progress. Next one. It strengthens the willpower muscle. So what I'm trying to say there is that when you go through a competition preparation journey of 3 or 4 months, then your ability to resist temptation, I found for me personally, got better and better. So in other words, you know, because I was so committed to, you know, making the stage 3 days ago, that I blocked out everything else that was going to distract me. And so consequently now, I find that I don't have, you know, I never really had too many urges anyway to have cheat foods, but I'm much more stronger with my willpower in terms of my cheat food eating and that kind of thing. And that, you know, we've given all the resistance and restraint that I had in the previous 3 months leading up to the competition, that has built my willpower muscle even more, that I'm basically unstoppable when it comes to resisting temptation. The next one, stage tanning is really important. I had no idea that stage tanning would be really essential because some competitors, their stage tan, they were sweating and their tan was literally like they just had a shower, was running off their body. It looked horrific. Now you need a stage tan because it's, and it looks ridiculous. It really does, it looks f-ing stupid. But when you're on stage, you're like this beautiful work of art. Everything shows. All the small muscles, like the serratus muscles, all these side muscles, they all show. If you have a look, you probably can't really see them on me. But with a deep tan, under those 3000 watt lights on stage, which are very hot, and it's very hot on the stage, everything shows, that the judges can see all of the small muscles and things like that. So if you're looking at competing, make sure you find somebody that has done competition tanning, not just your local salon or your local tanning parlor, whatever it's called, I don't even know what it's called. Make sure you go to somebody who specializes or has expertise in competition tanning, because there are different tans. I had 3 layers of tan. I had a base coat, a base tan, a stage tan, and then I had something else on top, like a gloss layer or something. I don't know. It's hilarious. So tanning is important. The next one is comp prep starts well before 3 to 4 months. Okay, so this is really for people that are looking at competing. I didn't just wake up and 3 or 4 months ago and then was like, I'm gonna compete. And then I had that physique, and then I just did 3 or 4 months of preparation, then I got on the stage. I've been training, if you followed my journey, I've been training for about 4 years. If you go beyond that, I've been training ever since I lived with my parents, doing push-ups and sit-ups in my bedroom, right? So 11 years ago. But I started lifting weights about 4 years ago. Like seriously lifting weights about 4 years ago. So I was already building my body and my physique 3, 4, 5 years ago. And then in the 3, 4 months previously, the last 3, 4 months, I've been taking everything that I've learned with the help of a coach to get me ready for the stage. So a lot of people think that, oh, well, that's a great body and everything and you look good on stage. But you'll find that for a lot of people that are on stage have spent years and years and years training. That's the reality, that's the truth. If you're watching this and you don't give a shit about competing, that's completely fine because you'll know if you know my journey, I was quite lean before I started this competition journey. And I maintained it for a number of years as well. The next one. Goodbye to your social life. Okay, so if you're looking at competing, you must accept one reality. Is that you're not going to be very social over the 3 or 4 months leading up to your competition. The reason being is because you won't be able to go to restaurants, you won't be able to eat what you feel like when you feel like it, you are stuck to a meal plan, and although you can design that meal plan around the food you enjoy the most, your ability to just go to a restaurant and eat what you want off the menu goes out the window. If you're serious about competing and getting on stage, you must be prepared to not go to restaurants and overindulge for, you know, 6 to 8 weeks leading up to the competition. Depending on where you are with your conditioning and how much body fat you have, and there's a bunch of other variables, and usually your coach will make that assessment. Remember, when I started my comp prep journey, I was in Thailand and I was going to restaurants, but remember, I was already quite lean when I started. So it's a little bit different. I was able to be more flexible at the very beginning, but even for someone like me that was already lean, I couldn't, when I came back from Thailand, there were no restaurants, there were no eating out. I was going to cafes, I was having long blacks and the occasional latte, but that was it. Everything else was on the meal plan. So be prepared to give up your social life. If you're looking at just losing weight, not competing, you can still keep your social life, but you still need to create a meal plan if you want to guarantee results. And I talk about this in other videos on this platform. Go and check them out. I give you strategies for how to lose a bit of weight, how to look good without completely losing your mind or without any desire to get on the stage. So I'm addressing two different types of people that might be watching this. You want to lose a bit of weight and not compete? Fantastic. You can still keep your social life because I have done that as well. If you're looking at competing, then you have to be prepared to give up your social life leading up to the competition. Not completely, it just means when you go out with your friends, you're drinking soda water. The next one, it is so much fun having the right attitude. For me, comp prep was actually really enjoyable. Really a lot of fun, even though there were tough times. There were times when I was always bawling my eyes out because of the pain in my back and zero carbs and all this kind of shit that was going on simultaneously. There were tough times. If you followed this series right through, you know exactly what I'm talking about and what I'm referring to. So I'm not bullshitting you there. There were definitely tough times, but there are a lot of good times as well. A lot of great times, a lot of fun times that I had training with my coach, a lot of laughs, a lot of great exchanges of banter, and you know, it was really being overseas and training and having different experiences. Even though it flooded, I was still having a good time in Thailand, even though the shit was going on and people were dying around me. So on that island, so I was helping businesses out by sandbagging, and I was keeping my chin nice and high and being positive and being proactive and not being the victim. So you just need to be aware that as long as you bring the right attitude to this, make sure you have fun. I know this sounds like airy-fairy pep talk bullshit, but it's very true. Like, as make sure you just have fun. Have fun and acknowledge the shit times. You're gonna have f***ing terrible times. You're gonna wake up, you're gonna be tired. You're gonna wake up, you're gonna be sore. You're gonna be in pain. You're not gonna wanna train. You go to your coach and you're in pain and she, you know, she wants to do these things and you can't because you're still sore from the previous 5 days of training. There are times like that, but if you laugh, if you crack a few jokes, if you have a bit of fun, it takes that pain away, at least in the moment. Have the right attitude. You will get through competition prep with the right attitude. And even if you're looking at not competing, just losing a bit of weight, remember, whatever program that you start, make sure you bring the right attitude to it. Have fun, it's the journey, enjoy it. You don't know if tomorrow's gonna come or not. There's no f***ing guarantees if you're gonna wake up and there's gonna be a beautiful day outside. You never know, nobody can guarantee tomorrow. So have fun right now while you can. The next one is that you don't need to water load or sodium deplete to win a competition. All right, so I wanna add to that by saying no steroids because I don't, personally, I'm not against anybody who takes steroids, but for me personally, I like to do everything naturally. So my whole journey has been no steroids and just doing everything naturally. And, you know, making the most of my genetic potential through everything I know with nutrition and training and all of those pieces put together. So I don't have the biggest physique out there, but I don't give a f*** about that because I feel amazing. I have great levels of health, I have great levels of energy. I help people transform their bodies through my online courses. and I get great feedback helping other people lose weight and inspiring other people through my own journey, that's all that f***ing matters. I don't need to have the biggest physique. I don't care. I'm happy with my physique. So I don't need to get bigger, you know, like a big body. I'm not into bodybuilding. So you can still win a competition without being on at least the federation that I competed under. So ICN or INBA. ICN is now the new name. I Compete Natural is what it stands for. And so I'm so happy to say that you can still win a competition. I did, by competing naturally. So, and I never did any water loading or sodium depletion. So if you're watching this and you're familiar with training principles and nutrition principles, you'd be familiar with water loading and water sodium depletion and that kind of thing. So I won't bore you with what that is. It just means that you manipulate water and you manipulate sodium so that you get shredded, right? You have that really shredded look on stage. So that's as far as I'm gonna go with that explanation. Don't worry, if you're looking at just losing a bit of weight, you don't need to worry about that shit. And if you're looking at competing, you don't need to worry about it either. I never did any water loading. I never manipulated my sodium or potassium levels. I just went in drinking the same amount of water that I was drinking throughout the whole period of the competition prep. And my sodium levels, were not changed. I didn't eat packets of chips or I didn't, you know what I mean? I didn't go crazy with that. I just ate normally. So I wasn't the most shredded guy out there, but you also lose points for being overly conditioned. And I knew that, which was one of the reasons why I didn't do any water depletion, water loading or sodium depletion. Next one is peak week is demanding and tiring. So if you're looking at competing, the week leading up to the competition is called peak week. It is tough. It is challenging. I took 4 days off work leading up to the competition. Another guy I spoke to, Sean Gregory, one of the other guys I competed with, great guy, he took 2 weeks off leading up to the competition. I know not all guys do this and not everyone has that annual leave that they can take from work to get time off leading up to a competition, like 2 weeks, for example. But you should take a few days off work leading up to a competition so that you can relax a little bit. You don't want to be stressed out at work. You want to just be zen. You spend that week, that peak week, getting things like tanning sessions, doing your tanning sessions, doing photography shoots. You know, you don't want to be at work. You don't want to be working. You want to be away from the office if you can. So I took 4 days off leading up to the competition. It was the best 4 days I could have taken off. Highly recommend it. So how I started to feel more and more fatigued during peak week. So yeah, you will get more and more tired during peak week. It's completely normal because for me, I was on a different meal plan and I was on very, very low carb. In fact, I was on zero carbs. I was on carb depletion for 4 days and then carb loading. And so that became, for that week leading up to the competition, all I was doing was meal prepping, eating carbs and watching my body change and monitoring for spillover. I know I'm speaking directly to the person who wants to compete out there, but this is what you do in the week leading up to a competition. My physical conditioning was ready 2 weeks out. So my physique, I was stage ready 2 weeks before the competition. So I spent the next 2 weeks just, you know, doing the posing, practicing a bit of posing, relaxing my mind, you know, and relaxing. And the last week of the competition, I actually didn't really train, didn't really practice much posing. I really didn't, because all the preparation was done. Most guys make the fatal mistake, so I'm told, of leaving everything to the last minute. All of their posing to the last minute. All of their preparation for the last minute. And they wonder why they don't place. And that's the reason, so I'm told. So, but remember, I prepared weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks ago so that I could have that peak week, which was relatively relaxing for me. It was tiring, but it was relaxing. I had 3 layers of tan. I had to buy some dumbbells. So I bought some small dumbbells so I could practice my pump up and do my, so I'd use the same dumbbells backstage to pump my muscles up to get ready for the stage. So in that last week, I had to buy some dumbbells. I was practicing my pump up routine, and I was actually practicing my pump up routine in the gym so that I knew what exercises would elicit the best pump for the stage. No one taught me to practice the pump up. I just thought it was a good idea that I should practice what exercises I will be using as my pump up exercises so that when I get to the competition, I will be able to execute the pump up, get maximum pump through my muscles so I can look my best on stage. Managing my intake of rice cakes and jam with pump up. So on the day of the competition, I had a schedule of what I would do every 2 hours. So every 2 hours, I'd have 5 rice cakes and I'd have 2 tablespoons of jam every 10 minutes during the pump up. So I was pumping up, and I had times written down of every 10 minutes, I'd have 2 tablespoons of jam. Energy, pump. Because when you're doing the pump up, you want to give it your all. You don't want to sweat too much, because if you sweat too much, the tan is going to run off your body and you're going to suck. So there's a fine line that you cross between getting maximum pump backstage, take the jam to give you energy, 2 tablespoons of jam, or honey. Some competitors use honey. I was taking jam, so you can have the jam on the rice cakes. I was doing that as well. Put jam, put it on the rice cakes, eat that, pump up. And whenever I started to feel like I was getting a little bit of perspiration, I started to slow down my pump ups. I stopped for about 5-10 minutes just to let my body cool down a little bit, because I don't want to sweat. I don't want to sweat this tan off my body. Then I'm back into the pump ups again. Pump up. Every 10 minutes, you know, 2 tablespoons of jam, rice cakes, yeah? Pump up. Okay, I'm starting to sweat a little bit under my armpits. So I get the towel and just do this so the tan doesn't run down my armpits. And then I was tapping the towel on my chest to make sure the tan wasn't gonna run down my chest. Because some guys had their tan like a little river running down the center of their chest. And I saw them on stage in video shot of, there's one guy, he had a tan, he had a river running down his chest. He was sweating, it looks terrible, it looks really bad. I feel sorry for that person actually, because you just lose your focus. You're not focusing on their physique, you're focusing on the tan line, the tan river that's running down their body. So just keep that in mind. If you're looking at competing, don't sweat. Do a really good pump up, give it your all. Don't sweat, have a towel with you and just tap the towel on your body whenever you start to, especially under your armpits, right? Under your armpits, under your neck, just tap the towel like this. Shaving and grooming, essential. I shaved my body a day before. I shaved it 2 or 3 times leading up to the competition. And then I shaved it again 2 days before, or 1 day before my base tan went on, okay, my first tan. Because I wanted to have the smoothest, I know this sounds really girly, I wanted to have the smoothest skin that I could possibly have. And then I started to exfoliate. So I shaved it, I exfoliated it, and so by the following day, I had this really smooth skin. Like, just imagine you're painting a house, so you want to sand back the walls first before you start adding the layers on. That's exactly, no, just no different. So shaving, exfoliating, and then the following day the tan goes on, yeah? And then that's the base tan, and then the following day I went back to the tanning lady's house and she put the stage tan on me, the second tan. And then the day after that I had the competition. Before I got on stage, she did final touch-ups. I shave a little bit here and a little bit here where it kind of smudged a little bit. And then that was my final touch-ups before I went on stage. So grooming, I decided to have a bit of stubble. Like, it's a little bit longer now. I haven't shaved since the competition, but I wanted to have a bit of stubble because I wanted a bit of masculinity to the fitness competition. Yeah, I don't want like a baby face and whatever. So I wanted a bit of masculinity brought to the table. So I left stubble there. Another guy told me that I should have shaved. He goes, you should have shaved before you got up on stage. I'm like, well, does it matter? I don't know. Does it really matter? Shaved, whatever, right? So I don't know, I have to get another opinion on that. So I'm not sure if I should have shaved or not, because everybody else had shaved, I didn't. I still won. Anyway, photo shoots. Okay, so if you're looking at competing, or if you're not looking at competing, you want to lose a bit of weight, remember I'm speaking to two people here, make sure you book in a photo shoot. And you know, you want to take good photos of the hard work that you've achieved in your transformation program, your 4, 6, 8 week, 12 week program, whatever weight loss program you, Jenny Craig, whatever. You want to get some photos taken of the end product. You know, it's really good self-esteem and self-confidence to see and to really capture what you've worked really hard to achieve. It's like you've got this blank slate and you've carved this beautiful sculpture, and it's worth, you know, the money. You are 100% worth it. 100% worth it. You are 100% worth a few hundred bucks it will cost you to get photos taken. All right, if you can't afford it, you can't afford it. I paid 700 bucks. I know I mentioned before in a previous video that was like $29, super cheap. Yeah, but I wanted a lot of photos. You know, it was like 50 bucks a photograph, and I got quite a few photos, you know, because I liked them all. So I was like, I'll have them. But it cost 29 bucks, you know, for like the photographer's time and all that kind of stuff. And then I still had to pay for the photos, whatever. Okay, whatever. But it was worth the 700 bucks. That's the punchline. So get photos taken, it's worth it. And I'm almost finished hiring a car. So I had to hire a car because of my second tan. If it rained on the motorbike, I would have been f***ed. So I hired a car and drove to the tanning lady's house at about 11 o'clock at night, get my spray tan, midnight, came home 12:30 in the morning, was up for another half an hour, oh my God, and then that morning I woke up and had to do the competition, right? So I hired a car. So maybe it's worthwhile, if you don't own a car, to hire a car for the competition. And having a DEXA scan, D-E-X-A. So a DEXA scan, I talked about this before in other videos. It's like an x-ray machine. It tells you exactly how much fat you have and how much muscle you have on your frame. So with that, you know exactly what your body composition is. It's much more accurate than a bathroom scale. Bathroom scales are f***ing ludicrous on their own. It means nothing. It means nothing. Bathroom scales are only valuable when you're using them in conjunction with a tape measure and other forms of measurements. But the bathroom scales on their own are ridiculous, right? You should stop using them if you can't verify your progress with at least 2 or 3 other types of measurements, like a tape measure around the navel, that kind of thing. DEXA scans, D-E-X-A, go to Google, type it in, find out where your nearest DEXA clinic is. It costs about 60, 70, 80 bucks per scan. You might be able to get it cheaper with a coupon. I've paid 30, 40, 50 bucks, I have actually. Not 700. I have actually paid 20, 30, 40 bucks for DEXA scans in the past, and it's fantastic. It'll tell you exactly what your body composition is, how much muscle you have, how much muscles on your right arm, how much muscles on your left arm, right? It's really, really interesting. If you're interested in measuring, then I highly recommend a DEXA scan before you start your transformation program, and get another DEXA scan after your transformation program so you can see whether you've gained muscle, whether you've gained fat, or whether you've gained or lost muscle, or you've lost fat. And you can see how much muscle, how much fat has changed in the course of that 3-month program by doing a DEXA scan before and doing a DEXA scan afterwards. It's fantastic. Don't get them every week, just get them at the beginning of a program and at the end of the program. And having an assistant to help you backstage. All right, now this is essential because for me, I had Sylvia, a friend of mine, she was my videographer. She chased me around with a camera and she was filming everything I was doing. So you'll see all that footage in previous videos of me and what I was doing behind the scenes. So she was following me everywhere with the camera. She was my assistant. She got me things when I needed them. Hey, Sylvia, can you please get this? I need this, I need this, I need this. And she was running around for me, helping me out backstage. So if you're looking at competing, looking at getting somebody that can do the same thing for you as well. Taking 4 days off prior to the competition day, we talked about that. And yeah, so that's it. I hope this was helpful. 14 things that I learned. getting ready for my first ever fitness competition. It's a long video, but this is what I've learned. Honest, to the point, I hope you can take value from this. Even if you're not looking at competing, you can still use these things that I've learned myself and apply them in your own transformation program as well. If you're looking at competing, make note of those and reach out to me if you're looking at competing. Share your story with me. I would love hearing people's stories. I hope I can inspire you in some way. Have an awesome day, and I'll see you in another video.